Every now and then, I come across code that just doesn't seem to belong in a mono behavior. Unity was designed around the entity component system pattern, where game objects are entities in your scene, and mono behaviors are the components that give them functionality. But some classes just feel weird being attached to game objects and treated like entities. Take this service class that acts like a wrapper around Twitter's API, for example. It could be injected all over your project, and used by any number of subsystems in your game. But it's a service, right? Not some entity that exists in your scene. So why not stick to a regular C# class instead of inheriting from MonoBehaviour? Well, that works, but what if we wanted to take advantage of some of the events that take place in Unity's lifecycle? For instance, at startup, we may want the service to authenticate with Twitter. And when the application closes, we may want the service to deauthenticate for security purposes. We may also want to use the update loop to periodically check to see if we've gone over our rate limit for the day. We can actually accomplish all of this thanks to a few interfaces that are included in the Zenject namespace: iInitializable, iTickable, and iDisposable. Classes that implement iInitializable must implement the initialize method. Initialize is called during Unity's start phase. This is in line with Unity's recommendation of including initialization logic in the start method, rather than in awake. Classes that implement iTickable, iLateTickable, and iFixTickable must implement the tick method. As you may have guessed, tick is called on update, lateUpdate, and fixedUpdate, respectively. And lastly, classes that implement iDisposable must implement the dispose method. Dispose is called when the app closes, the scene changes, or if the context object is destroyed, so it should be used for class cleanup. So now we can modify our Twitter API service to implement iInitializable, iTickable, and iDisposable. We'll authenticate and initialize, deauthenticate and dispose, and use tick to periodically check our rate limits. But we're not finished yet. Now we need to add some bindings. Taking what we learned from part 2 of this series, all we need to do is bind each interface to the class. There's actually a few ways to accomplish this. In fact, we could do this with a one-liner using the non-generic bind method. A little better, but unfortunately, it's prone to error. Like, what if we decided to remove one of the interfaces? We could remedy that, though, with a little bit of reflection. We're getting there, but to be honest, this is kind of ugly. Luckily for us, Zenject comes with a nice helper method that accomplishes this exact functionality. Bind interfaces to. Much better. Now, the whole point of this service is that other classes should be able to reference it. So now, let's add a binding for the class itself. Alright, but wouldn't it be great if we could figure out a way to do all of that in one line? Well again, luckily for us, Zenject comes with another helper method just for that purpose. And that's all there is to it. Your mileage with these interfaces may vary, but they do offer a pretty good solution for non-MonoBehaviour classes that need to hook into Unity's start, update, and on-destroy events. I find that I use them pretty often, but again, it all depends on your needs and your architecture style. If you enjoyed this video, please let me know by leaving a like and a comment telling me what you thought. And for more videos just like this one, subscribe with notifications on. And to support the creation of content just like this, please consider becoming a patron on the Infallible Code Patreon page.